Hi everyone, I'm David White. Welcome to the fastest 24-hour news updates, domestic and foreign news and latest news. Here, let's take a look at some of today's latest news. Cheap flights with a catch, the details behind the government's travel bonanza. Around 800,000 half-price airline tickets are being made available as part of a $1.2 billion tourism support package unveiled by the federal government. The scheme will encourage Australians to take a holiday interstate at a time when the international border remains closed. So how is it going to work? Where can I go? With the exception of a flight between Adelaide and Kangaroo Island, all of the discounted routes are for interstate travel. Destinations across 13 regions in all of the states and territories have been chosen based on their usual reliance on international tourism. Targeted tourism locations. The government has targeted these 13 locations for assistance, arguing they are particularly dependent on aviation for tourism during April to July. Qantas CEO Alan Joyce says the airline also advised the government on current demand levels, with some areas still struggling compared to others. This package will allow us to put 21 extra flights every week into Cairns, we'll be putting 35 extra return flights into the Gold Coast every week, he said. To Ballina, we've already doubled the amount of capacity to pre-COVID levels, it's full there. Prime Minister Scott Morrison has described the routes below as an initial list and flagged more locations might be added depending on how the scheme goes. Discounted flight limitations. Some destinations are only available from certain cities based on indicative routes. When can I get a ticket and what's stopping airlines from pushing prices up? Discounted tickets can be purchased between the beginning of April and the end of July, for travel through until the end of September. Qantas says its discounted flights will be available online from April 1 for travel from May 1. The government says the airlines are expected to start advertising the flights in the next couple of weeks, once the finer details of the package are agreed. The subsidy is open to any airline that has been flying the nominated routes in the past 2 years, meaning some regional operators will be eligible along with Qantas, Virgin, and Jetstar. The discounts will be calculated according to the average fare as of February this year, and Deputy Prime Minister Michael McCormack says the airlines have assured the government they won't be able to hike up prices. I've had long discussions with both Alan Joyce and Jane Heard-Lickow from Qantas and Virgin respectively, they're not going to do that, he told Sky News. Of course the ACCC, Australian Competition and Consumer Commission, has been monitoring air prices right throughout the pandemic and making sure that it is as what it should be. What's the point of booking a trip if state borders could close again? The government and the airlines say the success of this program depends on the states and territories not snapping their borders shut in response to future COVID-19 outbreaks. We really need those premiers, of course, to keep the borders open, we need the premiers to play ball, Mr. McCormack said. The Commonwealth is hoping the rollout of Australia's COVID-19 vaccination program means border closures are imposed only as a last resort. However, as we have seen throughout the pandemic, the power to impose restrictions ultimately rests with the states and territories, so there is no guarantee. What about international travel? When can I holiday overseas again? The Prime Minister says he is hopeful Australia's international border might reopen by the end of October, although he warns that is not yet confirmed. We haven't made any firm decision on these things, but that's our hope and that's our expectation, he said. But I've learned all through the pandemic, you don't get too far ahead of yourselves. The government is sticking to its aim of offering all Australians their first dose of a COVID-19 vaccine by the end of October, and Qantas is relying on that timeline to meet its plan of restarting international flights by then. We should get to a stage that 20 million people are vaccinated by the end of October, Alan Joyce said. And we know there's lots of things that the governments need to see before we can get there to the borders opening. Why is the government doing this? The announcement of this package comes ahead of the JobKeeper wage subsidy coming to an end later this month. The government argues that program could not be kept running forever, but with more than 600,000 Australian jobs tied to the tourism industry, it was under pressure to provide more support. Labour leader Anthony Albanese has criticised the package as too narrow, arguing the aviation sector is the only one to directly benefit from the discounted airfares. There's nothing in this package for hotel operators, there's nothing in this package for those people, for example, who are tourism operators, who will take people out on day trips, he said. If you're a tourism operator anywhere in Australia, who's been relying upon JobKeeper to keep your doors open and to keep your businesses going and to keep people employed, you're about to lose that support. So today's announcement, what it does is magnify that in just a couple of weeks, the rug is about to be pulled. Along with the cheaper airfares, the government is expanding a loan scheme for small and medium-sized businesses and is also extending financial support for travel agents and zoos. Will this package be enough to help tourism operators? The major airlines, unsurprisingly, have welcomed the package, but some tourism groups are unhappy, arguing it does not do enough to help ailing parts of the industry. Accommodation Association CEO Dean Long said the nation's capital cities had been overlooked. For Sydney and Melbourne, where 80% of the market is from international and corporate markets, which are still not operating due to government restrictions, the lack of support in this package will result in a loss of jobs and slow our recovery once borders are open, he said. The Australian Tourism Industry Council agreed, saying more jobs would be lost. There's been a very strong overreach to the regions, ATIC Executive Director Simon Westway said. Our capital cities actually do drive Australia's visitor economy. Trucking charges at Australian container ports are surging and consumers may foot the bill. Arthur Zanaros and his father set up their trucking firm back in 2005, but he has never seen stevedore charges so high. Based at one of Australia's biggest container ports, Port Botany in Sydney, ACFS Port Logistics has become the biggest privately owned container logistics firm in Australia. But the ACFS chief executive is worried about the future of his business. Mr. Zanaros said fees charged to load and unload cargo by port operators, known as stevedores, have increased by nearly fivefold since 2017. In the next 12 months, I think there'll be a bloodbath within the transport industry due to the introduction of these new fees, he warned. Figures from the Transport Industry Group, the Container Transport Alliance Australia, show the average fee for unloading an import container off a ship has surged from an average of $24.52 in mid-2017 to $121.87 in March 2021 in New South Wales. In Queensland, the fee has jumped from $34.63 to $118.59, and in Victoria it has surged from $27.07 to $128.51 in less than 4 years. Peter Anderson from the Victorian Transport Association said the problem for truckers is that shipping lines contract with a single stevedore for cargo, so they are forced to accept the charges to gain access to a port. In the supply chain of the port, the land side, transport, operators are the price takers, they are not able to dictate pricing, he said. There is a range of new and increased fees imposed by port operators like Patrick Terminals and DP World on transport firms to access the now privatized ports. Mr. Zanaros said a vehicle booking fee to reserve a spot for a truck to pick up or offload containers at Port Botany had jumped by nearly half over the past year alone. Patrick introduces long vehicle charge. Maritime giant Patrick Terminals has now introduced a new fee for longer vehicles, known as high productivity vehicles, in Sydney and Brisbane. The charge of $50 per long vehicle has been slammed by the CTAA as a productivity tax, and the transport group is calling for it to be abandoned. This is clearly unacceptable to transport operators and their import and export customers, as it simply adds significant additional costs into the use of highly productive and efficient road freight vehicle combinations that have kept the costs of transport down for the end consumer, said CTAA Director, Neil Chambers. Patrick Terminals Chief Executive Michael Jovicic said the new charge is needed because it takes more time for long vehicles, which have two or three trailers, to be loaded or unloaded, and he needs to employ at least one extra worker per shift. It can take at least an hour to load a long vehicle into berth, he told the ABC. He said Patrick is following government moves to reduce road congestion and encourage the use of rail by charging a long vehicle fee. Consumers and exporters foot the bill, ACCC. Mr. Zanaros disputes Mr. Jovicic's arguments about the time it takes for long vehicles to be serviced by stevedores. He added that there is not enough cargo capacity at Patrick's new automated rail terminal at the port, which is set to start full operations in a few weeks. Mr. Zanaros said the new charge is another heavy toll on truckers. The financial impacts on ACFS port logistics, specifically just in Sydney by the introduction of the long vehicle fee, will be in excess of $1 million per annum just into the Patrick terminal alone, he said. The Australian Competition and Consumer Commission said port operators saw revenue and profit margins rise for 2019-20, despite the global pandemic causing the largest contraction in container volumes in a decade, mainly because of the stevedores increasing their terminal access charges. Revenue from the fees charged to transport firms rose by nearly 52% compared to 2018-19. ACCC Chairman Rod Sims said the charges imposed by the port operators were unconstrained. Stevedores have managed to increase their profits, that's got a fair bit to do with the transport charges they're imposing, which have gone from not being there at all to mostly down the East Coast being well over $100 a container, he said. Mr. Sims thinks the rising costs are being passed on to consumers in the form of higher prices, although the ACCC has not done an inquiry. My view is this both costing Australian consumers and also costing our exporters, which is also important. Mr. Zanaros backed up this view, saying ACFS has been forced to pass on the higher charges to its customers, which include major importers and exporters. The pricing cascades all the way down to the consumer at a materially higher cost, he said. Mr. Sims said the ACCC has the power to monitor prices at the ports, but the industry is regulated by the states and territories. If action is going to be taken, it has to be by state governments, he pointed out. We are in discussion with state governments on how to react to these ever-increasing charges. Mr. Jovicic would not be drawn on the possibility of greater regulation of port charges. In terms of any fee changes that we have, we engage with the relevant state departments and we're transparent and we continue to cooperate, he said. Calls for Senate inquiry into supply chain bullying. The transport industry is calling for a Senate inquiry into the higher charges imposed by port operators. The Transport Workers Union wants an independent inquiry set up to assess higher prices, and importers and exporters have also called on regulators to intervene. Paul Zaleff from the Freight and Trade Alliance said importers and exporters were feeling the heat because of an estimated $300 million in supply chain costs imposed by stevedores at all major sea freight container ports. We estimate that $1.2 billion is being paid by importers and exporters just on these new congestion surcharges charged by shipping lines, terminal access fees by the stevedores, and extra staging and booking fees at empty container parks, he said. This is $1.2 billion in extra costs that didn't exist a few years ago. The Patrick Terminals boss said the port charges are needed for investment in infrastructure and maintenance. But Michael Caine, National Secretary of the Transport Workers Union, said the rising costs have forced trucking companies to cut wages and lay off staff, putting safety on the roads at risk. This is really supply chain bullying, he argued. We've got stevedores that are just gouging. They're making up these phony charges. Mr. Jovicic disputes that. That's simply not true, he responded. Our returns today are at historical lows, he said. The ACCC Container Stevedoring Monitoring Report for 2019-20 found that overall revenue for the industry rose to $1.4 billion, the highest in 10 years, with revenue from shipping companies falling, but earnings rising from transport and other industries. Of the $1.4 billion, stevedores earned $256 million from the unregulated terminal access fees. Deputy Prime Minister and Federal Transport Minister Michael McCormick is not intervening in the cargo dispute for now, but said the government understands how frustrated Australian shippers and transport operators feel. "We welcome the announcement from Australia's State and Territory Infrastructure and Transport Ministers, which have endorsed a plan to develop voluntary national guidelines for applying stevedore infrastructure and access charges at Australia's container ports," Mr. McCormick told the ABC in a statement. The National Transport Commission, as the National Land Transport Reform Agency, will lead this work and will engage with industry and jurisdictions on developing the guide.